Hi everyone, I'm Chums and welcome to That's Engineering. So in this video, we're going to have a look at surface electromyography, or SEMG for short. I will split this into two videos. In the first, I will explain what it is and the overall steps for signal processing. And in the second video, we will go through some MATLAB code that I wrote for a previous project. Now if you guys like this video, don't forget to give me a thumbs up. And as always, please subscribe. With that, let's begin. Alright, so what is electromyography or EMG? Now, EMG is a biomechanical process and it is used to measure the activity of a muscle. This is done by placing electrodes in line with the muscle you would want to analyze and then measuring the electrical signals sent from the nervous system to actuate that particular muscle. But if you put it formally, EMG measures the action potential of muscles, which are its levels of depolarization and hyperpolarization. So, EMG is usually split into two main types. You have SEMG and intramuscular EMG, which is an invasive method. Now, in intramuscular EMG, the electrode, which is usually in the form of a needle, is injected into the muscle and it follows the muscle's movements with its contractions and as it relaxes. Because the electrode is injected into the muscle, you would get significantly better accuracy, low sensor noise, less muscle crosstalk, less distortion. But the obvious disadvantage would be it's painful and it can cause significant discomfort to the person. Due to these reasons, it's rarely used. And if it is used, it's for muscles that are deep within the body. So the preferred method is actually SEMG, surface electromyography. And in SEMG, the electrodes are pasted onto the skin. They contain a conductive gel that is used to pick up the electrical signals sent from the nervous system to the muscle. It's easy to perform, and you do not need any qualified medical practitioner to set up and run SEMG systems. However, the disadvantage is that there would be quite a lot of sensor noise and it is subject to muscle crosstalk and movement artifacts. Due to these reasons, signal processing must be conducted. So the effectiveness of SEMG greatly depends on how well you place the electrodes and set the system up. Now, if you want the exact details of what procedures to follow and at what locations the electrodes should be placed for each muscle, you should check the Cenium project, its website online, which is more or less the standardization body for SEMG. Apart from this, a few points to follow would be to shave or remove hair in the area where the electrode will be placed, clean it with spirits, and keep the electrodes in line with each other, and make sure the wires are arranged neatly to avoid people tripping or tearing the wire or anything like that. Care should also be given when placing the ground or the reference electrode. You should place it on a bone segment. I typically use the collarbone for this purpose. Alright, so let's move on to signal analysis and processing. Now, various pieces of literature would recommend different methods to analyze these SEMG signals with different values and different outcomes. This is because there is no standard way of processing these signals. It all just depends on the type of study you are doing and the results you would want to obtain. That being said, I will run through the steps I usually use, and this can serve as a general model when analyzing SEMG signals. So for my experiments, I used a Biosignals Plux SEMG data logger with OpenSignal software. Now this is the screen on OpenSignals, and you can see I had 6 channels, each corresponding to a pair of electrodes. And based on the data I got, I plotted the raw SEMG data for 3 channels or 3 muscles, which are the tibialis anterior, gastrocnemius lateralis, and medialis. So all this data processing was done on MATLAB, and this is the raw SEMG data plot. Now if you look at this, you can see a lot of distortion and sensor noise. So the first step in processing this signal would be to filter it. So to create the filter, the cutoff frequencies have to be found. And to do this, a fast Fourier transform can be performed, or an FFT. So when I performed an FFT for my signal, I obtained a plot of frequency, versus their intensities. So these are the frequency ranges that are contained within my signal. And by analyzing this plot, we can decide on cutoff frequencies. So it can be seen that after around 300 Hz, the intensities of these frequencies become quite low. These high frequency components are mainly caused by sensor noise. They are undesirable and should be filtered out. On the other hand, it can be noted that after around 30 Hz, the intensities rapidly increase. So everything below 30 Hz is also not really needed. Interestingly, these low frequency components are due to movement or motion artifacts. So if you're not sure what an artifact is, practically it's noise or distortion caused by unwanted movement of the electrodes when placed on the surface of the skin. So based on the fast Fourier transform I performed and the signal I obtained, I chose two values for cutoff frequencies, which were 30 Hz and 300 Hz. Now, like I mentioned earlier, there is no standard way of analyzing this. So you can use whatever values you want to use. And keep in mind that your signal would be quite different to my signal. So your cutoff frequencies would change. But generally, you would want to remove any high frequency components and a few low frequency components as well. So with that, we can now implement our filter. We would want to filter out components greater than 300 Hz, hence our low pass cutoff frequency, and components below 30 Hz, hence the high pass cutoff frequency. So with that, we can implement a band pass filter. We would have cutoff frequencies at 30 Hz and at 300 Hz. And everything within the pass band will not be filtered. Now, I usually use a fourth order Butterworth band pass filter, although I have seen some researchers go up to using sixth order band pass filters. On the other hand, I've also seen some pieces of literature describe using a low pass filter directly after the band pass filter. So all this is actually optional. It depends on you and the study you are performing. The next step after filtration would be rectification. Now let me explain why. So if you look at the raw SEMG signal here, you would notice that there are both positive and negative components, due to which if you were to calculate an average of the signal, for example, the mean power, it would be equal to zero, which is statistically insignificant. Now this is because both the positive and negative components would cancel each other out when calculating an average. Due to this reason, the signal has to be rectified or undergo full wave rectification, and this is done by taking the absolute value of the signal. So this is the plot I obtained after filtration and after rectification. As you can see, there are only positive components. Alright. So the next step depends on the type of study and the relevance of the SEMG data you would want to collect. Generally, we would try to find the power or the mean power of the signal. To do this, we calculate an RMS envelope. And this can be done by taking a moving average of the original signal followed by a root mean square for a given window size. So you can see this in the plot over here. The blue signal is the filtered rectified signal that we obtained earlier, and the red line shows the mean power of that signal or the RMS envelope. Now this window size, you can play around with the value. There is no standard value to use. I usually use 50 milliseconds. You can choose to use a value greater than this, and for a larger window size it would encompass more of the original signal, but it would also be more spiky and thereby have a bit more distortion. On the other hand, you can use a lower window size, but this would result in a rather flat signal which does not reflect the peaks and the bumps of the original signal. With that, the final step is normalization. So if you wanted to compare the readings across different subjects or different people, then you would need to normalize your SEMG signal. And there are a few methods to do this, but the most common is to compare your signal with an MVC or a maximum voluntary contraction. So basically, an MVC is the maximum possible activation of a muscle, and it can simply be obtained by asking a subject to contract that particular muscle as hard as possible. The MVC is used as a baseline, which means the RMS envelope, which is the mean power of the signal, can be directly divided by the MVC, and this can be represented as a percentage. So this value would be your final SEMG reading that you can use to compare across different subjects. Another such method is called PDM or peak dynamic method. This is more credible than MVC, so I suggest reading up on it if you are performing this sort of signal analysis, but I will not go through that in this video. Alright, so those were the general steps for processing an SEMG signal. Just to recap, you would start off by recording your surface electromyography trials with the maximum voluntary contraction, and the MVC can simply be found by asking the subject to contract that particular muscle to with as much strength as possible. Based on this, you would obtain the raw SEMG signal, and this can be used to find the fast Fourier transform to obtain the cutoff frequencies for your filter. You can then run the signal through a bandpass filter, followed by full wave rectification, and then calculate a moving RMS envelope, which would show the mean power of the signal. This can then be normalized in relation to the MVC, and appropriate conclusions can then be drawn. Right, so that's all for this video. I hope you guys enjoyed it and learned something. If you haven't done so already, please give me a thumbs up by clicking the like button below. Now, if you guys have any questions or clarifications on the work we just did involving SEMG signal processing, please feel free to leave a comment and I will do my best to get back to you. I hope this video helped you, and if you haven't done so already, please subscribe. I'll see you all in the next video. Thanks for watching and cheers.